Thank you. just don't know what I'd say. I'm not worthy to speak your holy name. Yet you tell me that you love me just the same. I lift my hands in praise. Humbly I adore you. This is what I say. I keep falling in love with you. I'm drawing nearer to you. This is what I say. I keep falling in love with you. I'm drawing nearer to you each day. Lord, I worship you. Be loved by me.
Yes, He is. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, tonight. Thank you, Lord. It's a wonderful, fun, wonderful day to be a Christian. Amen. I'm telling you, in the days that we're living in, I wouldn't want to be without Christ. I wouldn't want to be without His grace, His mercy, His love. Knowing the Word of God, discerning the times, I wouldn't want to be without the Spirit of God. Amen. And so I'm grateful tonight, hallelujah, to be in a company of believers. I'm in a company of the body of Christ and in the company of the redeemed. Amen. Grateful tonight. So thankful to see you all here. And we're going to go before the Lord because we've got some folks that are out sick. And so we want to pray that God touch them and bring healing to their bodies. And so let's just agree in prayer. And I know that many of you have needs and requests. This is the time. Let's lift them up before the Lord, okay? Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight for this time to come and bring our prayer requests before you. We have sung the songs of Zion. We've worshiped you, Lord, and praised you. And Lord, this is the day that you have made, Lord. It's our time of visitation. It's our time, Lord, to come before you and bring every petition. And Lord, I just pray tonight that you would minister to those that are sick and afflicted. You'd minister, heal, Lord, and touch each and every one that's not here. Touch Sister Skiles. Touch Lord Charlotte tonight. Touch my family, Lord. Touch those that are out. There's many, Lord, that are going through things and they're sick and afflicted in their body, Lord. And they're going through times in their life, Lord, that are just very difficult. But God, we know that you're the God who specializes, Lord, in things that are impossible and difficult, Lord. There's no challenge for you. Nothing's too big for you. You're an awesome and a mighty God. So I pray you just intervene on these and minister by your Spirit and your power. And we give you all the glory and thank you for answered prayer. And we ask this in Jesus' most holy name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you tonight. You can be seated. I'm going to have Becky come receive the offering tonight. But there's just one particular announcement that I have been asked to make. And so she can receive the offering after I make this. First of all, there's young adults tonight. Amen. Praise the Lord. And so I have to focus on this. I don't have my glasses on. So please pardon me. And I got to put them on. There's just no way around it. Wow. Praise the Lord. So they need help setting up for the women's brunch on Friday at 9:30 p.m. They need help tonight, correct? Right. Friday. I didn't know if the brunch was on Friday or if you need help on Friday. So we need help setting up for the women's brunch on Friday at 9:30 p.m. Amen. I read it correctly. So if you can help out, please see Priscilla, or and she's not here tonight. Let somebody know, Becky or Patty or Sister Skiles, because we need to do that. That's just tomorrow night, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Amen. Otherwise, Pastor's going to be doing it by himself with a handful of other people. So come. If you can help out, we appreciate that. And Becky, why don't you come receive this offering tonight?
Amen. Thank you, Pastor. Just to add to that, we do have to move chairs out of the sanctuary. So, brothers, if you're not doing anything tomorrow night at 9:30, we would greatly appreciate the help because we have to take down the sanctuary because we're going to have our event here in the main sanctuary, and there will be tables and stuff. So if you can come tomorrow at 9:30 to help, we would greatly appreciate it. Sisters, the event starts Saturday at 11 a.m. here in the main sanctuary. Like Pastor says, we want you to come. We want you to be a part. It's going to be a wonderful time. Just going to have fellowship and fun and just celebrate the season with one another. So please come. We love to have you. Amen. And like Pastor said, if you have any questions, you can see myself, you can see Patty. We will try to answer them for you as well. So I encourage you to come and be a part of that. If you say, Becky, I didn't sign up to bring anything, that's okay. Just come. There will be plenty of food. There's always plenty of food at a New Life event. So just come. We're going to have a wonderful time in the Lord. For the young adults and the youth, on Saturday, December 11th, we are having a scavenger hunt around the city of La Habra. If you've been on one of those before, you know how much fun they are. So it's going to start at 5 p.m. that evening here at the church. So youth, young adults, I encourage you to come and be a part of it. If you've never done one with us, it's a lot of fun. It does get a little competitive, and we have to rein it back in. But we have a great time, so I hope you can come and be a part of that. Don't forget, we have several opportunities for you to give this season during the holidays. Don't forget the TJ, the rehab home and TJs. I know they still need supplies. So if you can bring powder creamer, blankets, I don't know what else is on the list by memory, but if you can donate towards that would be great. And there will be other opportunities throughout the next week that you will be able to participate in. help to be a blessing to children in their community and various outreaches. So we encourage you just to pay attention to our social media, as always, Instagram, Facebook, our announcements here in the church, and we will just let you know of all the wonderful opportunities to give this season, because it is about giving. I know kids and teenagers, we like, and adults, we like to receive, but it is about giving. Amen. And as the ushers prepare to take this evening's tithe and offering up, I want to remind you, we sang about heaven tonight, that he's coming soon, and this world is not our home, church, and things of this world are temporary. As we have all learned in the last 2 years, things are very temporary. Things can change in a moment. So as the Bible says, store up your treasures where rust and moth do not corrupt. Don't build your kingdom here, because it's just going to burn and melt away. But build the kingdom of God by giving. Give in missions. Get involved in our various outreaches. You're like, Becky, it's 10 bucks. You know what? 10 bucks to a man who just came off the streets off of TJ, that's a gift. That's a blessing. You know, there's definitely ways to be a blessing. And I encourage you, this is not our home. I know we want the latest and greatest. Trust me, I'm one of those people. I like all the new phones. I like all the new gadgets. The Lord's kind of delivered me from that, but he's working on that. but we want all the new stuff, don't we? We want the new purse, at least I do, purses and technology. And our kids, they want the newest gaming device and whatever. And that's all fun and great, but it doesn't do anything for our eternity. Right. It's just stuff. But when you give to the kingdom of God, when you're obedient in your tithes and offering, you give in missions and you participate in the various outreaches where you can give and be a part, you're building the kingdom. You're building for eternity. You're not building for here and now. You're making an impact now. But you're ultimately building for the kingdom. Now I encourage you this evening to give, to be faithful, and build the kingdom. Don't build your own personal kingdom. Build God's kingdom. That's what we're called to do, especially in these last days. Amen. Amen. Brother Will, will you pray over the offering, please?
Saved me by his grace. When he takes me by
Thank you, Lord, tonight. Thank you for your giving, your offering tonight. We greatly appreciate that as pastors of the church, and thank God for your faithfulness. And at this time, we're not going to take up any more time. We're going to go ahead and dismiss all that are going to go to their classes, the kids, the youth, young adults, and thank you, worship team. Turn with me in your Bibles to the 118th Psalm. Psalms 118. Psalms 118. Don't you love the Word of God? Thank you, Lord. You know, you folks are just easy to pastor and easy to preach to. I just appreciate you so much, and your response, and I have heard from all speakers we've ever had as they talk about this church, and Pastor Jay just got back to Ireland and thanked me for the opportunity to preach, and he just said, you know, he just loved the church, appreciate the fellowship and everything. It was just good to be with the body of Christ, because he's in an area in Ireland, well, the UK as a whole is just very spiritually dead. I know there's still a church there, but he said it's just, you're looked at as a Christian for the most part, like they did back in the communist days in Russia, whenever they were under communist rule. And I remember Zhenya telling me, she said, if you're a Christian, you're looked at as ignorant, you're looked at as stupid, you're looked at as uneducated. And, you know, that's the persecution that you experience. They just think that you're just, you know, beneath the elite of the you know, the culture. But I can tell you there's a church in Ireland, and it's a remnant church, and Pastor Jay pastors one of them. But I appreciate him so much, and he's so thankful to come here to be in service with us. And so I appreciate you all giving to the speakers that have come. We have gleaned and received from them as they've taught us. I'm going to read one portion of Scripture and then pray, and I'm going to preach for a little bit here. Psalms 118, verse 24, and this is what it says. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And I'm simply preaching a message tonight. This is the day. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for the worship. We thank you for giving, for the opportunity for us to give. And in our giving, we worship you, Lord. And I just pray that tonight, that as we open up the Word of God, that you'll talk to us, you'll instruct us, you'll encourage us, you'll strengthen us. God, you'll pour out your Spirit upon us. And God, build us up in this most holy faith and your Word tonight. And I pray that you equip me, you anoint me, use me for your glory to speak the Word, and we'll give you all the glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Now, I'm using this passage in the 24th verse of Psalms 118 as a foundational scripture for my message tonight. And you know, days are very important to God. In fact, there are 28 days in Scripture. Well, there's actually more than that, but 28 specific days in Scripture or kinds of days in Scripture that we read about. And I'm just gonna quote them, not the scriptures, but there's a scripture or two or three to back up what I'm saying. But there is a day of wrath, a day of temptation, a day of trouble, a day of power, a day of adversity, a day of prosperity, a day of death, a day of gladness, a day of his fierce anger, a day of grief, a day of vengeance, a day of affliction, a day of evil, a day of calamity, a day of his indignation, a day of darkness. In Joel 2:2, he talks about a day of darkness, a day of distress, a day of his coming, a day of the Son's revelation. When I say the day of his coming, in Malachi 3:2, we know he is speaking about, I believe, the forerunner. But he goes on to say, the day of his revelation, the day of the Son's revelation, I should say, the day of salvation, the day of redemption, the day of Christ, the day of the Lord, the day of visitation, the day of his wrath, the day of God Almighty, the day of judgment, and the day of God. And we'll hit on that a little bit later. But there are several places in Scripture where we read about days. Now, why did I quote those to you? And there's many scriptures to back them up, and more so. Because God puts great importance upon days in Scripture and days in general. In fact, God made the days from the very beginning. Did he not create the heaven and the earth and everything that he created in days? He divided it up in slices of time called days. And it says in Genesis 1:14, and I want to read this scripture to you, but Genesis 1:14, and I didn't write all these down. I wrote them down on my notes, but I didn't write them down so I could quickly quote them. But Genesis 1:14 says this, because we're doing more of a word study tonight. But it says, and God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. And so we know that God created slices of time in creation into days, because it's very important to God. Why? I know I can't speak for God why he did it other than this reason, and I can surmise this, that God's eternal, and eternity is a day without end with God. So why would he create a day for us and have several places in Scripture that we know of where there's the division of days? And I can only come to this conclusion that it's an act of God's grace for us. Why is it an act of God's grace for us? Because our finite minds could not process a life with no days. Can you imagine an existence without a day? I'm telling you, we would be people that would never rest. We would be people that would just give everything and never take time to, take time to pray, take time to be in God's Word. That's why he spaced out time, and he said the specific day of the Sabbath day was for you and I to rest and also to come and worship the Lord. It's a time to be rejuvenated, refreshed, enriched. That's why you shouldn't be watching football on Sunday. You should be in the house of God. People shouldn't be missing church for something that's worldly. I can tell you, we need to give God the time that belongs to him. And that time, you know, and that's just obedience unto God. And I don't make any apologies for saying that, because it's in the Word of God. I don't apologize for anything in the Word of God, but I certainly don't apologize whenever he tells us we need to be faithful. And so, but I believe God knew that we, it was His grace, because our finite minds cannot process a life with no days. It's our human nature to live and think and worry beyond the day that's at hand and present right there before us. It's in us. We're made that way. That's why we're always thinking about the next day or the next week, whenever you don't even know if you're going to be here. Right? Jesus said in Matthew 6:34, take no thought for tomorrow. Why? Because verse 30, He said, in the same chapter, Matthew 6, He said, because we don't even know if we're going to be here tomorrow. Let me read that scripture to you. Let me quote it to you tonight in Matthew 6. We quote 6:33 all the time, but let's read it in its entirety here, because we're going through the Word of God. But in chapter 6, starting with verse 30. He said, wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, so it's here one moment and gone the next, shall He not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewith shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all these things. Let me tell you something. God's never not taking care of us. He's always taking care of us. And, you know, He will continue to take care of His people. He knows how to feed us and clothe us and make sure that our needs are met. But he said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for tomorrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. So what we learn from these scriptures is, when Jesus is telling them, focus on just submitting yourself unto God and completely seeking Him first. Don't worry about the things that you aren't even there to worry about yet. Don't even concern yourself with that. Sufficient for this day is everything you need from God. And sufficient for this day, I can tell you, is evil too. There's all kinds of things that you don't even realize that are taking place around you. There's a devil. There's a hell, an agenda from hell, and a devil, and an enemy, an adversary that is already plotting, scheming, strategizing to try to rob you and I of our day. Of the goodness and the blessedness of our day with the Lord. He's trying to ruin our day. Have you ever said, my day is ruined? Let me tell you something. We have to be so in tune with God that no matter what happens in our day, we're not going to lose the victory. Amen? Because the victory cannot be contingent upon circumstances. Joy is greater than happiness. Happiness is contingent on happenings. And no matter what happens, I still got joy because I got Jesus. Amen. And so reading this in Luke chapter 12, verse 20, he was talking about the rich man that said, I've got these barns and all of this fruit. And I'm paraphrasing, but all of this. And he said, the man said, you know, soul, what shall I do, soul? I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to tear down these barns. I'm going to build bigger barns. And he said, don't you realize how foolish that is? Because today, your life is required of you. See, what you didn't realize is you were planning and preparing for something greater upon this earth. But you didn't even realize that tonight, your life was going to be taken. Tonight, your soul was going to be required of you. So church, what am I saying? God is saying, this is the day that I have made. Rejoice in it. Live for me. Give everything you've got unto me in faithfulness and obedience, and the blessedness of God will come for that day, because you may not have tomorrow. You may not have tomorrow. Our focus must be on seeking Him first. In Colossians 1:16, it says, for by Him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible, invisible, whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, powers. All things were created by Him, and all things were created for Him. So He created you for Himself. You and I, He created days and sliced up this thing we call time in days so that we could give Him our day. That is what we were created for. I know we work jobs. I know we have households to run, children to parent, schools to go to, all of these things that are part of life. God understands that. But he also wants you to know that everything that you do, there's a central theme there, a main thing in your life, and that's God. He must be the center of all things. So when you're going to the grocery store to buy your food, there may be somebody you need to talk to about God. When you're on the job, you must realize this day was made on this job for this person to be touched by God, because there's a world out there. They're not coming to church. The church has to go to them. And we have to live before them with a great faithfulness and a great joy and a great witness. As we've been preaching, we have the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will make us witnesses. The witnesser, there's a witness of His Spirit in us, and we will minister to people as we come across their path and encounter them. So this life isn't just about all these things that we have to do. God is trying to work things, do things behind the scenes, or do things in the midst, I should say, not behind the scenes, but do things in the midst of our everyday activities in life that we don't even realize. This includes when it says that all things were created by Him and for Him. This includes my days. It means this day was made for Him, and the only way it will work is if I live for Him, because in so doing, I am fulfilling the one reason it was created, and I was created. Why did God give me another day? Because He wants me to worship Him. He wants me, are y'all happy? He wants me to live for Him. He wants me to serve Him. There's a purpose in that day. Amen. There's a purpose in that day. So we must dedicate our whole life and order our day according to His will. Please see this. There is a reason that Jeremiah wrote Lamentation 3, verses 21 through 24. There's a reason. Now, if you've studied Jeremiah, the prophet Jeremiah, you know that Jeremiah wrote Lamentation. And Jeremiah was a prophet, and he was a weeping prophet. He went through a lot of things. He was put in prison. He was pretty much left, almost seemed like he was abandoned, but he wasn't abandoned by God. God was just using what he went through and his experiences of affliction to understand and kind of be able to prophesy with passion and with fervency about the wrath of God to the people of Israel. You know, whenever you've been somewhere and you've done something or you've been through something, you have a voice and you have an experience that speaks volumes that somebody else may not have because they've not been where you've been. When you've been through a divorce, as tragic as it is, you understand how it feels to be left and abandoned, rejected, whatever. When you've been done wrong, when you've been betrayed, when you've went through a great loss in your life, you understand death like nobody else, or like somebody else that hasn't experienced that in their life. So there's things that we go through, and what they do is they make fervent, they make potent, you know, our testimonies and the things that we speak and the witness within us. They give it a great power and a voice that it wouldn't have otherwise. And so God allowed Jeremiah to go through those things that he went through, being put in a dungeon, being seemingly left. But he had a heart for God, and he had a faith down deep inside. And reading in Lamentations chapter 3, verses 21, this is what the scripture says. He said, and you would have to read the first 20 verses to understand how he feels. But then you come into this horrific time of verses 1 through 20. And then he says, "But this I recall to my mind, therefore have I hope. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul, therefore will I hope in him." I love that, because it says his mercies are new every morning. I quote that often. I speak it often because we have bad days, difficult days. But there comes a day whenever everything changes. And church, one of the things that has to take place in our life is we have to know that even though we're going through a dark time or a difficult time, I should say, a stressful time, it's been a stressful week, a stressful month, a stressful year, there's coming a day, a moment when everything's going to change. God gives you a hope. People can say, I was going through a trial and then it was like something happened and everything turned around. Everything turned around. I remember my sister, she had a breakdown, and I remember she was in the hospital, and she said to me, she said, Jonathan, I remember it hit me one day. She said, I realized, you know what, if I continue taking this medication that they're giving me, I'm going to be stuck here forever, but I've got to get out of here. They think I've lost my mind, but I've not lost my mind. And she said, I had to actually, at that moment, there came a moment when she realized, if I don't change course here, I'm going to be here forever. So she said, I started hiding the medication under my tongue. Because she said every time they would give me that medication, I would just be asleep for days or all day. I'd lose the whole day, but I knew. And she said I quit taking it. I would spit it out when they'd walk out of the room. And so she said, but there came that moment that day. And I remember praying. I said, God, my sister needs a miracle. And I'm praying for that moment and that day when you're going to walk through those walls and you're going to give her faith. You're going to give her something to hold on to get out of there, because she's really in a hospital that's a prison right now. And that day came. His mercies are new. Everyone, I'm telling you something that happened that maybe you can identify with, or maybe you've had that moment where you said, I remember whenever God touched me. He gave me a faith. He gave me a hope that today is going to be different. My mercies are new today. And that goes for every one of us. Every day is a new day with God. Every day is a new day of His mercy. And Jeremiah was experiencing the affliction of the wrath of God. God let him feel that, but also down deep he had a hope of a brighter day. His mercies are new every morning. Tomorrow is a new day. Now the Lord knew our spiritual needs were daily. Our spiritual needs are daily. I know that we treat them like they're weekly. Some people come to church on Sunday and they don't open their Bible the rest of the week. They come back and say, Pastor's going to preach to me on Sunday. You don't live on one meal a week. Do you? No. Nobody in here has one meal a week. Nobody. Amen. I can tell you, we live on 3, 4, 5 meals a day, little or big. Somebody said, wow, but come on now. I used to have 3 squares, and then they told me just go to 6 smalls. But if you're not careful, you'll go to 6 squares before you know it. And then the next thing you know, you'll have to get some bigger pants. But the Lord knew and knows our spiritual need, and they're daily. In Matthew 16, verse 11, it is the scripture where Jesus is speaking about the Lord's Prayer and telling the disciples how to pray. And He says, when you pray, pray this way. And in Matthew 6, 11, this is what He says. He says, when you pray, after this manner, therefore pray ye. Verse 9, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Now, those are prayers concerning, a spiritual dimension and worship unto God. He's not confined to our day. But I can tell you, He says, as far as you're concerned, and I'm concerned as believers, give us this day our daily bread. Because God allots us this space of time in a day. And He says, you need to pray, give us this day our daily bread. And in the midst of all of that, let us remember that we need to forgive and ask you to forgive us of our debts as we forgive our debtors. In other words, we need to ask forgiveness. We need to give forgiveness or offer that, extend that to others. He said, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen. reading this, I thought, Lord, it's so powerful. You said, give us this day our daily bread. God knew we needed His Word daily. But the Lord's Prayer is a daily reminder of not just the bread from the Word of God, which He is the living Word, the living bread that came down, the bread of heaven. He's the bread of life. He is that which we are to partake of every day, but also throughout that Lord's Prayer is a reminder of all things, to be forgiving, to forgive, to seek that He would lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil, that we would be mindful of our own spiritual life for that day. If it's out of sight, it's out of mind a lot of times. Thus why we need devotion, communion, daily reading of God's Word. If we don't hear the Word of God, we're not going to be a doer of the Word of God. We're certainly not going to be it if we don't hear it. We must be doers of the Word, but we must be hearers of the Word first before you can be a doer of the Word. And when we read God's Word and we take in for that day, that which He gives us for that day, because I'm talking about a specific day in our life, one day in our, tomorrow will be a new day. We need to know, today I need to learn God's will, and I learn that from His Word, and I learn that from praying, and the day will be, it will be worked, or everything that happens in my life will be worked around the will of God. It will fall in line with the will of God. We learn to be forgiving. We learn to seek forgiveness. We learn that there's a tempter every day that's coming to try to derail you and I. Amen? And only God, by divine direction and instruction from the Word, will lead us every day. Our daily steps of the righteous are ordered of the Lord. It's important that we take in the Word of God, that we have a relationship with God, and that we're in the Word of God, because faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God, because you are responsible for your walk with God, your experience with God. There were 12 spies that went into the promise, or went into Canaan land to spy out the land. 10 of them came back and said, we cannot do it. They're bigger than us. We're like grasshoppers in their sight. They're like giants. We're like weak, and we could never take over that humongous promised land and the Canaan land. But two of them, Joshua and Caleb, said, we can take it. We can do it. So they were people who had faith. There were two men that had faith, and they hung on to that faith even through the midst of what was judgment, really, and what was a waiting period of 40 years of the children of Israel roaming around the wilderness. They never came into the promised land until after 40 years. What could have taken 11 days, or should have taken only 11 days, a straight shot into that promised land, they marched around that wilderness for 40 years. What am I saying this for to you? Every day you must come before God, because He's going to speak to you, and every person has their own individual perspective. They have their own individual walk. They have their own understanding. They have the faith that God gave them. Some believe, some don't. Some read the Word of God and they go, yeah, that sounded good. Other people will read it and go, wow, that's for me today. Something hit me. James 4:7, the scripture says, submit yourself unto God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. The Lord just spoke to me something powerful, and it's something He did down deep inside. Because I'm going to say it to you, and you're going to be like, well, I've read that before, and so what profound meaning do you have to say? I don't have anything profound to say to you. It just profoundly happened in me. Because I read it. And it spoke to me. And He said, submit yourself unto God and resist the devil. Resist him whenever the enemy comes to tell you to talk about somebody. Resist him when the thought comes to your mind. Resist him whenever you want to say something to somebody because they made you mad. Resist him whenever he tries to get you to turn on something carnal or something worldly. It may not even be something that's illicit or perverted or something lustful, but it's something that's going to get your mind captivated here instead of there. And he said, this day belongs to God, and you have to resist the devil, because if he can't get you to sin, he's going to get you off occupied in something that's idle that will bring spiritual death to you simply because you're not taking in the life of God. You're taking in some news or something like that. And I'm not saying you shouldn't at least know what's going on in the world. But my Lord, it's depressing. So are you hearing me? It's depressing. I've never lived in times we're living in. And I don't want to get ahead of myself, but God knows what we need. And, you know, our daily steps are ordered of the Lord. The Bible says that the steps of a righteous man are ordered of the Lord. Every day we take steps. Every day is a new walk, a new fresh opportunity experience. And we have to make sure that we don't lose that time, because we're never going to get it back. You see, the devil doesn't just want to rob you of your purity and your righteousness and your prayer time. He wants to occupy the one commodity that you have, and that's time. Don't let him do it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Sufficient for the day is the evil for it. I can assure you that. It's there. It's lurking. Doesn't the Bible say in 1 Peter, 2 Peter, he says that the devil goes about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. May he devour you? He may or he may not. If you resist him, he will not. But if you don't resist him, he will, he can, he might. But you know, there's that word might and if in the Bible. And that means it's contingent upon what you do, on how you act, and upon the decisions you make. And so I just want to encourage you tonight and exhort you that as we pray and seek Him, the Lord by His Holy Spirit will reveal unto us a lot of things. And one of the things is that He wants to bring His kingdom down here to this earth. He wants heaven. He wants God, His love, His grace, everything that is of God, everything that is pure and holy and lovely and of a good report, everything that is of heaven that could change the life of a person down here, which is God and Christ and His love and all of His character and nature. He wants that to come out in our daily lives, and we have to make sure that we sow to Him and to that on a daily basis, so that that's what will come out of our life. And so, as we pray and seek Him, the Lord by His Holy Spirit reveals His kingdom, His purpose, and the mystery of it. The mystery that the world doesn't understand or know. They don't understand and know. And, you know, there's a group in our culture that has put a great emphasis upon climate, okay? And I can honestly step back and say, okay, there are things that are scientifically known and seen. And so, okay, so the earth may be getting a little bit warmer. I promise you it's going to get a lot hotter. Okay? But because they don't understand the mystery of godliness and righteousness and of God, and it's not a mystery, it's just a mystery to them. We know, we understand. They don't. So in their minds, they're thinking, I got to do everything to preserve this earth. And so they give their whole life to that. But I can tell you this much. This earth one day is going to melt and run together. It's going to be destroyed, the Bible says, with fervent heat. But they don't know that. That's why they have to know. We have to tell them, and if they reject it, it's one thing. But if they don't ever know, that's on us. We have to seize the day, redeem the time, and we have to share the gospel with people and share the word of God with them. And, you know, but getting back to this, you know, God will begin to reveal every day to you His mystery, the kingdom of God, the purpose of God, and the mystery of everything concerning God. It's not a mystery to us. He reveals things to us. And you'll read the word and you'll be like, wow. But you're looking at people that you're around and they're dead spiritually. You're not, but they are. And you're like, they don't get it, but we have to tell them. This could be their day of visitation. Now, we are told in Matthew 6:34, sufficient for the day is the evil. Also to redeem the time, for the days are evil. We are living in an evil, evil, evil day. We have been for some time. And I stopped counting how many shootings this week there have been in this country. I mean flat out just shootings, just school shootings. It's like every day you flip on the news on the internet or whatever, your smart news or whatever you got, and it's like another shooting, another shooting, another shooting, another shooting. And church, I'm going to tell you something. The guns are not shooting themselves. A wicked person has it in their hand, red and yellow, black and white, it doesn't matter. They're driven by the enemy. They're driven by jealousy. They're driven by anger. They're driven by a demonic force. And they're operating upon what is in them, okay? Set aside anything else but the fact that a person has a deadly weapon in their hands and they're not being submitted and governed by God and His Word. And so these things are happening. As we live in an evil and a wicked world, it's like unbelievable. You know, we've seen and it's been proven that it's not a gun. It could be a vehicle. A man can plow through and murder I don't know how many people with his car. It's not an object. It's the person that's being driven to do that. I watched, and I wished I wouldn't have watched it, but I couldn't believe it that they even put it on there. But a man went over to pick up his son, November 5th, I believe it was, to pick up his son. He's divorced from his wife. His ex-wife is there. The new husband's there. And he goes up and he begins to confront the wife and tell her, the ex-wife, I want the kid. He was supposed to be here at such and such time. She wouldn't surrender him. It was a court order thing. Her new husband goes in the house, comes out with a gun, and shot him dead. I thought, man. We're living in dark, dark, dark days, okay? And church, I'm going to tell you this. Maybe to a certain degree, you might be able to have legislation that will cause somebody to think about the consequences, but you cannot legislate morality. Only God can change a person's heart. You understand? Because even when you have legislation, and I know, you said, well, if we didn't have any legislation, there'd be utter lawlessness. I know. But church, we're almost there. It's like every day it's something new across this nation. Now listen, we're living in a difficult day, a dark day, a day of lawlessness. We're heading to the days, like it says, Jesus said in the days of Noah. He said that the end times would be like the days of Noah. Man's imagination was evil continually. And why am I telling you this? Because I want to say some things to you. First of all, racial tension is at an all-time high. Every day, we need to armor up. And I'm not so much talking about your gun. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the whole armor of God. I'm talking about every day saying, Lord, cover me from head to toe, from the top of my head to the sole of my feet, and cover me in your blood of protection. Cover my children, cover my wife, my husband, whatever. When you're praying, pray, cover my family in the blood of Jesus. Cover my car. When you get in the car, you should say, God, protect me as I go. Protect me. Cover me in your blood. Plead the blood every time you walk outside the door, because I'm telling you, it's just getting to be a real chaotic, dark, evil outside the walls of your home and outside the walls of the church. You know, it's the day of the spirit of Antichrist and of lawlessness. We're here. This is where we're at. And it's not just here. It's around the world. God revealed to me, and listen, what we are witnessing is a harvest of reaping of 50 years of murder by legislation. He said 50 years is actually over a generation in the Bible. But we're seeing the harvest, should I say, and it's an ugly harvest, but the reaping of saying that life doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. And that's why we have what we have today. There is no value of life. And if God didn't bring about a revival during Noah's day, I'm not saying that he couldn't. He didn't. But he did not bring about a revival. But if God did not bring about a revival during Noah's day, but rather destroyed the inhabitants, I believe that's where we're headed in times. It's biblical. It gets to the place to where man's imagination is evil, always wicked. And that remnant was just a handful of people that got on that ark. And there was a day when God shut the door to that ark. And it was over for everybody outside of that ark. But we know we have the ark of safety in Christ Jesus. That's why I tell people, get on that ark. Stay on that ark. Stay in that house under the blood of Jesus. Stay under that protection. Oh, you're making it, you know, you're causing me to have fear. You shouldn't have fear. You should have confidence and hope and trust in what Christ has done for you and I. But I want you to know the seriousness of the times we're living in. So work while it is day, the Bible says, because the night cometh when no man shall be able to work. Live daily for two things or two reasons. And I want to read these and then we're going to close in prayer. But in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11, I want you to turn there with me. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11. He said, "Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul." Strangers and pilgrims, he's not talking about we're estranged from God or estranged to the people in the body of Christ. He said, you're to be a stranger to this world. You're to be a pilgrim passing through. You're not to get so connected here that, you know, they can't tell the difference between you and them. But dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul, having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. Now, why did I quote this? Because we need to be prepared for ministry in the day and the moment of their visitation. Because there's going to come a moment of visitation for every person. God's going to see to it that they have a moment and a time of visitation. And, you know, we need to be prepared for that. We cannot... When the moment comes, whenever they need to talk to somebody about how they're feeling about life, about eternity, about their soul, we need to have not lived a slipshod kind of example that they would say, "Ah, don't go to them. They ain't no different than the rest of us." Okay, we need to make sure that we have a walk with God, that every day we walk with Him faithfully, so that when they see us, they say they're a faithful man or woman of God, a faithful Christian, a faithful example. And they have lived a life, they have a witness of God within them, they have a testimony and an example, and you know what? I'm going to give them an audience. I'm going to give them an opportunity. I'm going to give them my ear. I'm going to let them talk to me. Have you ever had somebody say to you, and maybe you haven't had this happen, but I've had it happen to me, and I know many of you have had this happen, where somebody said, "I won't listen to anybody else, but I will sit and listen to you. I will listen to what you have to say about God." because I've watched you, and if anybody's been real, it's been you. I've seen you. And so you're going to have that happen as you walk before God, because people are watching your life. This is their, could be their day of visitation. This could be their season of visitation. Make sure that you don't mess it up by a bad example. Amen. One day I was taken, this was before Aunt Maida passed away. I took her down to St. Jude. And, you know, Aunt Maida, she was in and out of the ER. They knew her by first name down there. They knew her social before we even walked in the door. She just fell, and she broke her foot. She broke her hand. She broke her hip. So she lived down there at St. Jude. They knew her well. And I remember I had my New Life shirt on and had pastor, you know, this big on the side here. I told Becky and Angela, could you guys just tone that down just a little bit? You know, could you bring it down to like a really small font or just remove it altogether? And so here I am with my church logo and pastor, you know, on a billboard on the front of my chest. And here I am. And I'm standing at, Maida started getting testy with me. And I felt myself starting to get upset, you know. And I was like, you know, and so she's yelling at me, and I turned around and I said, can I get a wheelchair? And he said, sure, pastor. And I thought, how does he know I'm a pastor? How does he know I'm a pastor? I was like, oh, it's right here. Just as big as Dallas, right here. And so the Lord reminded me, he said, you were getting ready to get upset with Aunt Maida. And he said, you had people standing there watching, and you didn't even realize that they know exactly what you do for a living. And look, folks, look at me. I'm not angelic. I'm not perfect. I get upset like everybody else does. I have to bring things under subjection like everybody else does, okay? I've learned a lot in 31 years, so I can say I've come a long way. But I will say this to you. I'm human like everybody else, okay? And I have to work on things just like you do. Or God's working on me, I should say. But people are watching. People are watching. I was in Verizon the other day. I was going to go in and get me a new phone. Well, don't worry, because they don't have nothing for months, okay? So just save your time and keep what you've got for a while, because you're not going to get anything for a while. And so they're out there on those containers out on the edge of the ocean. But I went in there, and I'm sitting down, and I'm trying to communicate with this guy to see if I can get a new phone. And this man comes over, and he pats me on the back, and he goes, thank you for your service. And I was like, I wasn't in the military. It was right around Veterans Day. And I thought, I've got the pastor shirt on. Got the pastor shirt on. It's a smaller pastor, okay? It's a much smaller pastor, but it's still there. And I said, oh, okay, thank you. I do this unto the Lord. And I thought, amen. Not that I don't want people to know I'm a pastor, but I don't want to be put on blast like that, you know? And, you know, and so nobody has plumber across their shirt or electrician or, you know. Maybe they do, but anyway. I'm just trying to say, in their day of visitation, you want to make sure that you haven't set a poor example. So always live your life before the Lord every day, and you'll walk like you're supposed to walk, talk like you're supposed to talk, act like you're supposed to act, and love people. They'll see Christ in you, and you will have an audience with them. Okay? Be prepared for that day and that moment. The sinner's moment of salvation. Be always ready to give an answer for that hope. And the second reason why we should make sure that we consider every day is this. Peter tells us in 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 1. He says, this second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, in both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior. Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days, how many knows we're living in the last days, scoffers walking after their own lusts and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, All things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. And I know somebody's probably going to say, but Pastor, a lot of people, they know something's going on, and they realize that we're living in the last days, and they're troubled about that. They're not that troubled because they're not in the house of God. Okay? So they may think there's something, but they're like, it's all going to pass and everything's going to go back to normal. I'm going to tell you, the only thing that's coming back is Jesus. Normal's not coming back. Jesus is coming back. But he said that they would be saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. For this they willingly are ignorant of that by the word of God the heavens were of old and the earth standing out of the water and in the water. He's talking about Noah here, and or what took place in the deluge. Whereby the world that then was being overflowed with water perished. But the heavens and the earth which are now by the same word are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us. We're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. In other words, he said, you should look at the word of God. They may scoff, they may act like nothing's going on, but if you can't tell that we have utter lawlessness in our generation, you are blind, because it's bad. And he said, but don't lose hope, because God's promises are going to come to pass. He's not slack concerning his promises. He could have come back on the day of 1967. He could have come back on the day of 1948 when Israel became a nation. When things began to turn and the end times were clearly seen and known, Christ could have come back. But thank God he didn't come back before I got saved and you got saved. And there's still people that need to be saved. And so God's not slack concerning his promises, but he's not willing that any would perish. Any, but all come to repentance. And so that's what he's saying. But he said in verse 10, did I already read 8 and 9? He said, but the day of the Lord, you see, day. There's day here. This is very important to God. The day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Seeing then all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in all holy conversation and godliness? You know, I know that the trumpet of God's going to sound, and the dead in Christ are going to be raised first, and then we which are alive and remain alive are going to be caught up to meet him in the air. 1 Thessalonians 4:16 and 17. The Bible says in those verses, it says that we are to comfort one another with these words. Well, you know, you can't be comforted with words that you think or scriptures that you think you're going to go through a horrific tribulation. And I'm going to tell you right now, we may go through the beginning of sorrows, and we are. We may be going through difficult times, and we are. We may see even greater, more persecuting times, because every generation, especially the New Testament generation, the days of the church's development in the early stages, they went through great persecution. They were put to death. They went through tremendous persecution. What makes us think that we're not going to go through something? And I know people would say, well, I believe in an escapism. I believe the Lord is going to take his church out of here. In fact, when it talks about a thief in the night, if you and I are watching and waiting for him, we're going to be ready for him. Just like whenever the bridegroom comes, I'm telling you, came to that door. They knew he was there. They saw him coming. They They knew that. But you and I have to know tonight, amen, that those that are going to go and be in that number are going to be looking for him and watching for him. In fact, Paul thought it could have happened in his day. That's why he told them, be watchful and keep your eyes upon the eastern sky. Church, what I'm trying to say to you is this, that there is a generation that has rejected God, and they are going to go through a day and a time whenever they're going to be destroyed in judgment and the wrath of God is going to be poured out. But we, I read in Corinthians and I read in the scriptures, there's a day of the Lord. There's a day of God. There's a day of Christ Jesus. And in the day of Christ Jesus, I believe numerous times in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 8 and Hebrews 10:25, the day of Christ is a day and a time when he's going to come back for him. Or call his church home, I should say. Call us home. And Brother Clendenin said it so perfect. He said he's just going to call his Holy Spirit home. And everybody he's in is going. Church, listen. What am I saying to you today? I'm telling you, redeem the time. Because there's going to come a day when you can't work anymore. The day's so dark you can't do anything. The day is going to come when there will be no a possibility for work to be done anymore. Whether that's a day and a time where, you know, before the rapture of the church, we do not have an opportunity to work because of whatever, the times that we're living in, or we're not going to be here. There won't be any more opportunity to preach to anybody anymore. Say, well, we'll be in heaven with the Lord. I realize that. But there will be people that will have never known. We must redeem the time while we have the time. Because what we can do today, we may not be able to do tomorrow. Okay? But I want you to know I'm a pre-trib rapture believer. And if I'm wrong, and there's people that disagree with me, and if I'm wrong, it really doesn't matter as long as I'm ready and watching and looking for the return of the Lord. When he comes back, I can tell you, whether it's pre-trib, which I believe, mid-trib, or post-trib, the fact of the matter is he's coming. He's coming for his church, and his church needs to be ready. And Peter said here in the scriptures, and I'm reading here and I'm closing with this. He said, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, and the earth also and the works thereof shall be burned up. So seeing that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you and I to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God? See, there's the day of the Lord, the day of God, the day of Christ in Corinthians and other places. Wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to this promise, look for new heavens and new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that you look for such things, be diligent that you may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. And account that the long-suffering of the Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. Now, and then go down to verse 17. He said, Ye therefore, beloved, seeing you know these things before, beware lest you also being led away with the error of the wicked fall from your own steadfastness, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen. All I'm simply saying to you is that God has given us days to work. He's given us the day to serve him. He has sliced out time so that we're not overwhelmed with a whole lifetime without any division of days, so we can compartmentalize what we need to do for that moment. All God's telling you to do is take it one day at a time. Live for me one day at a time. And know that I've given you everything so that you can make it through that day and live and have faith and have grace and have everything that you need. And also to combat the enemy who's watching to destroy your day, destroy you in your day. And know that there's going to come a moment in time when there's going to be your last day upon this earth, whether it's by grave or by the rapture. And there's going to come a day when every ungodly person that rejected God and rejected Christ, his son, and the redemption, is going to die in the wrath
of God poured out upon this earth. I'm going to tell you, church, we need to be ready. He's coming. Take advantage of the day, because there's coming a time when there won't be another day. We'll arrive on streets of gold on the day that has no end. Thank God. Don't be discouraged. Say, I'm going to work and occupy until he comes. But there's going to come a day when I'm not going to have to deal with this old rotten world anymore. Amen. And if that bothers you, you need to get right with God. Because this world is not our home. It's not. You know, something hit me the other day. I thought, you know, I'm going to be 50 next year. And I'm not old, but the older I get, as time progresses, I start thinking about, you know, you get closer to that part of that end of your life or that season of your life, that stage of your life. And you say, Pastor, you shouldn't think about those things. I don't care who you are. You start thinking about that as you get older. You start thinking about what's important. You start thinking about what really matters. You know, holding on to all this stuff doesn't matter. You can't take it with you. It's going to do you no good. You know, I remember Grandma Jeannie had this paintbrush, and she was brand new. And I painted the house and did all kinds of projects and jobs for 20 years or 14 years when I lived there. She would never let me use that paintbrush. I mean, it just sat up there on that shelf, and she was like, oh, that's my brand new paintbrush. And I thought, what good is it doing on a shelf if you can't use it? Are you going to put it in a trophy case and make it a... No. And one day I remember, I said, Grandma, you know, I guess I'll go down and I'll buy a paintbrush. And she goes, you know what, Jonathan? She walked in there. I just saw it. It's like God just delivered her. Seriously. She goes, give me that thing. She goes, we can't take it with us anyway. She goes, you might as well just use it. It's just a paintbrush. I remember I thought, woo, Jesus just delivered her from that paintbrush. But that's how we are. We have things we've bought we don't ever wear. Amen. We buy more cologne, or we buy another watch, or we buy another this, or we buy another that. Oh, somebody's saying, please, can we? I thought you were going to close. Now you're kicking up dust. We have all these things. And you know what? I've realized as I'm getting older, none of that stuff matters. Because when you're gone, I got a whole storage full of stuff from Aunt Maida. And guess where? It's going. To Savers or to the Goodwill or something. She never took none of it with her. Am I saying you can't have nice stuff? No. What I'm telling you is that in our minds, though, we think, I got to have more, I got to have more, I got to have more, I got to have more. No, you don't. You don't have enough closet space for what you got. You can't. Give that to the kingdom of God. Or to reach somebody and change their day and the day God's given you. Amen. Father, I thank you tonight. I just pray that what I preach will touch somebody's life and make us think. That's all I want to do tonight, Lord, is make people think about what's important. And what's important is that we may not have another day, so we need to seize the day that we have and worship you and praise you. And live for you and give you every part of our day because it belongs to you. You created it, and God, you gave it to us to be a steward over. So I'm asking you to help us to be good stewards over our time and our days, not just our money, not just our bodies, not just our finances, but our time and our days and our opportunities. Please help us, Lord. I thank you today, and I ask your blessing upon this congregation. Bring us back on Sunday. We give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you go.